I talk a lot about social exchange on this channel. As humans, we have this need for a sense of connection to people and to the world. So we communicate to express ourselves and make impressions on others. But what I feel like we forget nowadays is that communication is a two-way street. Because of the information overload that is present everywhere and our own irresponsibility concerning sorting out information, our fear of not being heard is stronger than ever before. Hence, we mute a lot of voices that are desperately trying to tell their stories and use this silence we created to speak as loudly as we can about our own issues. Whereas hearing out others is essential for us too. We need to hear the different dimensions to a story in order to understand how we relate to these situations, what we can do about them, and what our role is in this bigger context. My name is Zoltan, and this is Game Appeal. I believe that interactive media can be a fun way to explore stories that draw parallels between virtuality and reality and help us comprehend more. A few weeks ago, Colin and I came up with this idea to do a collaboration with a bunch of other creators, and I thought it would be the perfect opportunity to promote empathy by showing how differently we perceive games, how we talk about them, and what we look for in them. So today, I want to step off the stage and make room for other creators to talk about a video game they found helpful or meaningful in any sense. Please enjoy.
Hello, it's me, Darkfry, the manifestation of society's deepest fears. I make fun, quirky, and hopefully thought-provoking videos analyzing game design, because I have nothing better to do in this black, boundless void I'm trapped in. If you're like me, then one of the most fascinating aspects of game franchises to you are their fandoms. It's always fun to diagnose a fandom, right? Smash fans are ungrateful, Fire Emblem has a gatekeeping problem, etc. If you're even more like me, then you think that the most fascinating of these fandoms belongs to the Mother series. These people are passionate. They don't just like these games, they adore them. They feel an attachment to the series that almost no other franchise can match. And if we are literally the same person, you have always wondered why that is the case. Play these games and you will find that answer very quickly. These games resonate. They know how to make you feel. Very few games strike the right emotions at the right times, as well as Earthbound. And don't even get me started on Mother 3. They're oozing with charm. You get familiar and attached with the characters instantly, just from the way they're written and presented. Of course, this is contrasted with the bizarre behaviors and speech patterns of these same people when something is amiss in the towns. Empathizing with these characters comes very naturally, and Earthbound can deliver very strong emotional moments because of it. It's no wonder that a game that does this, and so much more, has such a devoted fanbase. Of course, someone can say, pretty weird how in the same game where you're supposed to empathize with the people around you, you can initiate combat with a random hippie and smash his head in with a baseball bat, presumably leaving him a bloody pulp in the middle of the streets. Why, I say this is a classic case of ludonarrative dissonance. Which is a bit nitpicky, but I get it. If you have such a criticism, then my friend, do I have a game for you. If the mother fanbase is passionate, then Undertale's borders on obsessive. For good reason, too. Undertale did something truly incredible. It's obviously heavily inspired from Earthbound. It's also brimming with charm, and achieves similarly powerful emotional moments because of it. However, it went a step further than Earthbound. It took those strong emotions and made them playable. The charm, likability, and personality of the NPCs were given to the enemies as well. The story, the writing, the characters, everything changes depending on how you choose to treat these characters. It made empathy its core gameplay mechanic. It cannot be understated just how powerful this can be. What an incredible experience this game gave to so many people and what it made them feel. It's a perfect, not to mention simple, demonstration of how effective games can be as vehicles for feeling or even teaching empathy. When you think about it this way, how Undertale formed a fandom that makes others look tame in comparison seems like a no-brainer. See? Told you playing Doctor with fandoms can be interesting. That was all I had to say. Darkfry out.
So games can make us feel things through different game elements like plot or character development. A few games like Undertale even give you control over the plot and let you write your own story by making in-game choices that affect how NPCs will treat you. But is there something we can gain from interactive media that we can actually use in real life? The main criticism of video games is that they are but toys, implying they only satisfy our craving for fun and cannot be utilized else. I believe everything we find fun is worth our full attention and respect, even as adults, because we might get a lot more than a burst of entertainment. Just like physical toys encourage kids to learn and use their spatial imagination, creativity, and to socialize with others, video games have similar effects on people of all age groups, just in different ways.
Much of my writing is about the positive effects games can have on our sense of well-being, so I've always been open to the idea that games can be used not just to distract ourselves from real life, but as interactive arenas that can challenge us into learning and growing. Studies show that engaging with emotionally complex, interactive narratives in video games can efficiently deepen our self-knowledge and even strengthen our emotional intelligence skills. One of my favorite examples of a game that offers us a chance to learn and grow would be Fulbright Company's Gone Home. As the character Katie Greenbrier, we return home after some time away only to find no one is home. We look around for clues about where our family is. It seems like a spooky setting or a premise for a supernatural thriller, but what we find is a collection of objects that tell the story of our family struggling with many familiar challenges. They are either struggling to relate to one another or struggling with their own identities or emotional lives. The entirety of Gone Home's gameplay is submerging yourself into not only the cognitive shoes of this family, as in understanding their actions and thoughts by retracing their lives through items and letters, but their emotional shoes. We can actually strengthen important and useful emotional intelligence skills from this game mechanic. The four skills that inform our emotional intelligence are emotional perception, emotional integration, emotional understanding, and emotional management. Respectively, these skills are about focusing on the recognition and expression of unique emotional states, understanding emotions' influence on cognitive processes, understanding the causes, process, and consequences of emotions in self or others, and regulating emotions in the self and in others. This game gives us great practice on sharpening a couple of these skills. Although I've never gone through half of the turmoil that these characters went through, playing this game, I somehow felt as if I could completely feel their pain, confusion, anger, and sadness. Without even seeing or meeting the characters in the game, I was invested in their lives and wanted the best for them, particularly for our character's younger sister, who's trying to discover who she is while her parents silently struggle with their own self-worth and inter- and intrapersonal relationships. In life, we can grow a little blind to the emotional lives of our loved ones. Particularly when we're in pain, we forget what others are going through. Gone Home is a great game to help us remember that although others may seem cold, distracted, or impatient with us sometimes, they are often this way because they are experiencing immense stress, pressure, or fear in other parts of their lives that we usually don't have access to or can barely imagine without guided help, something we only receive rarely, and this game is an example of that help. As Katie, we learn of our family's secrets, but the advantage is that we aren't Katie. We're not particularly troubled to learn about the potentially confusing or painful details of her parents' or sister's personal lives. What we're left with is the correct impression that our loved ones aren't perfect. They're often distracted by their own sorrows, and we haven't understood them completely, and they, like Katie's families, could use the same curiosity, patience, understanding, and compassion we practice as Katie towards her fictional family. This is a helpful perspective that aids our emotional understanding and emotional management in real life. In the end, although we see that nothing for the Greenbrier family is really fixed, we do learn that each of the characters are trying their best to find compromise and grow. They're mending some relationships, reconnecting with their creativity, or blazing a trail for themselves in the world. These characters definitely have long journeys ahead of them, and not everything is perfect. And we do learn that a lot of the pain and confusion that they felt could have been avoided if the family had worked on their own emotional intelligence skills to establish open communication and acceptance between them, but despite all this, the story still feels encouraging. Through these characters, I practice understanding my own emotional struggles, I revisited what it was like to feel as the sister did, I practiced empathizing with the parents and opened my mind to accepting that all relationships with others and ourselves are full of pitfalls. But with practice and mindful application of EI skills, skills that this game helps us sharpen, maybe we can bolster our defenses against harboring assumptions, grudges, or bitterness. In essence, Gone Home is a great early example of an empathy-strengthening interactive narrative that we could all benefit from playing for a few enlightening hours.
Sometimes we say things like, "I will believe it when I see it." Since over 80% of our perception is mediated through vision, our sense of reality is highly influenced by what we see. We will trust our eyes with our lives, in almost any case. However, every now and then, our senses will deceive us, and our connection to reality gets disrupted. Think of all the times you were scared alone in a dark room as a kid. Knowing there is no monster under your bed only helps so much when you randomly see a movement in the shadows or hear a creak from underneath. You probably had to get up and convince your eyes that there was nothing to be afraid of by switching on the light and realigning your perception with reality. You quickly realized that only your fear was real. The cause was definitely not. Ever since games have been a thing, developers have striven to create a truly immersive experience that feels real. one can argue that games and virtual realities will never exceed the limits of virtuality. And that's true. We will always have the option to switch on the light and exit the simulation. But that doesn't mean simulations can't trigger real emotions in us. Just like we are capable of fearing non-existential matter under certain circumstances, so can we relate to fictional in-game characters that have an emotional impact on us.
It's Kat from Pixel A Day. The games that have emotionally connected with me are the ones that really make me feel like I'm inside someone else's body or mind, or both. Like the stories in What Remains of Edith Finch, a game about a string of family tragedies in which you play through the final moments of each family member's death. The story that really affected me most was the story of Lewis. Lewis's story begins in a grim place, in therapy for drug addiction and working a menial job at a cannery. The game puts you in Lewis's shoes as you are forced to carry out the dreadful, repetitive task of chopping fish heads, allowing you to feel Lewis's misery and boredom. Then, as Lewis begins to escape the dull monotony of his job through daydreaming, a playable bubble appears on the left side of the screen, allowing us to play through Lewis's daydreams. This section starts out small, but slowly takes over more and more of the screen, becoming more complex and taking up more of your attention and concentration. Eventually, it becomes quite difficult to navigate the fantasy world as well as continuously chopping fish heads in the real world. Through the mechanics, the game actually makes you feel like Lewis does, struggling to navigate both realities. And as Lewis drifts away and becomes inextricably drawn into his fantasy world, so do we. By the end of the sequence, the right side of the screen, which contains the dwindling remnants of the real world, has disappeared completely. We vividly experience Lewis's disconnect from his sense of self and his sense of reality. Something about this story connected with me. I still remember being a weirdo kid, having almost no friends and getting bullied a lot at school. I dealt with it by escaping into daydreams. I used to constantly drift off into my own world and drive my teachers crazy with my absent-mindedness. Unlike Lewis, my story has a happy ending. I was lucky enough to get a fresh start in high school, and I was able to make some new friends, gain some self-confidence, and become a happy and well-adjusted person. And I ultimately stopped losing myself in daydreams. But I think this sequence resonated with so many people because the temptation to avoid your problems by diving deep into a different world is all too understandable to those who have struggled with escapism or addiction. And Lewis's story portrays that process with such compassion that anyone, even those who have never experienced these issues, can play it and for a few minutes imagine what it would be like.
This urge to escape reality comes from being unsatisfied with the current state of it. Escapism is a tool to create an environment where we don't have to deal with our problems. But above all, it's also what prevents us from moving forward and accepting our situation, because it tells us to either distract ourselves or look the other way instead. Our ability to accept and express ourselves without feeling shame suffers from staying invulnerable in the comfort zone for too long. We always need new ways to prove that our flaws don't actually make us less valuable as a person in order to be able to accept them as a part of us.
Hi, I'm Eben Phantom. I make highly edited reviews, retrospectives, and list videos about gaming. Videos are my creative outlet. It's something I've been doing for a couple of years now, and it's been a great way to talk about one of my favorite hobbies. Self-expression is something that is very important to me, but I only really started exploring it when I put myself out into a more public space. When thinking about a game that covers the themes of self-expression, as well as friendship, destiny, and the fear of being unknown, Wondersong stands above the rest. For those outside the know, Wondersong is a story-driven puzzle game where you play as an overly optimistic bard trying to save the world from ruin. The colourful, whimsical visuals and music on the surface hides an intricately well-written story that has some of the best character development I've seen in gaming, all in a 10-hour package. I want to explore the way that self-expression is used through three of the characters and how it made me reflect on my own views on the subject. The bard is our playable character, and immediately we are told that he is not the hero. But that's okay, because he still may be able to save the world if he learns the Earth Song. He's incredibly positive, optimistic, and sees all the beauty in life. He's propped up as this idealized version of someone who is very comfortable in their own skin. He's not scared to dance and sing around others, he wants the best from everyone around him, and will never take a no for an answer. But by the end of Act 3, when the true hero is revealed and he is told that the Earth Song won't work, his entire persona shatters. He loses his vibrant nature, his personality shifts to that of someone accepting their terrible fate. He was told a lie that he could save the world, so now that the actual hero is here and the world is still going to end, why bother, right? Eventually, he comes back to his senses, but his enthusiastic charm comes with more vulnerability. He's terrified of the world ending and is jealous that Audrey gets to be the hero. This really solidifies his character, as he becomes unafraid to speak the truth and is unwilling to sit back and watch the world end without at least trying. He understands that there is a lot of bad in the world, so if he is able to make it better by singing, dancing, and expressing himself, then that's exactly what he's going to do. Now, while the bard is a great example of someone who's a lot more outward with their expressiveness, I find Miriam to be much more relatable as someone who also struggled with knowing who they really were and what they wanted out of life. In the beginning, Miriam is cold and constantly annoyed with the bard's antics, but over time she lets herself open up to him more and more. In Act 5, while you're in the City of Witches, you can find Miriam dancing in a club. What starts as an awkward moment turns into my favourite scene from the game as Miriam and the bard dance with each other while Miriam vents out her feelings. Her exclamation that trying to figure herself out is exhausting really hit home, as it can be very emotionally taxing. She also says how much she admires the bard for being able to stay happy even when he's in way over his head. Being able to come here and dance while talking through her emotions is very cathartic. By the end of the game, she also talks about how scary it is to be close to someone who is always positive, as she feels worse about herself for sharing bad feelings. While Miriam never becomes as extra as the bard, her growth over the game shows her trying to better process her feelings and her fears. Self-expression doesn't always need to be some big, eccentric show. Finding simple ways to let both your positive and negative feelings out is more than enough. Now we come to Audrey the hero, and this is where I'll be getting a little more personal. Audrey is chosen as the hero by Aya, and the hero's job is to kill all the overseers to end this cycle of the world. She's famous, she's powerful, she's loved, and it's all she ever wanted. At one point in the game, you get trapped in a cavern with Audrey and she loses her sword. She is immediately defeated as she thinks she's completely useless without it. This is another excellent scene as we get to see Audrey talk about her feelings on being the hero and also ending the world. Before she was the hero, she felt small, weak, normal. She's scared of the world ending and knows she has the power to change this path she's on, but she won't. Her entire persona needs to revolve around being the hero, even if it means pretending. She's not being her true self. She's trying to fit a role that will make the most people proud of her. If she wasn't the hero, she would just be a nobody, a failure. For the longest time, I chased a dream that wasn't really what I wanted out of life. The reason? I wanted to make the people around me proud. I locked away the things that made me happy, the things that let me express myself so I could fit the mold of expectations of those around me. I felt trapped in a life that was not dictated by me. I was lucky. I managed to find the courage to change that direction of the course I was taking. Yes, it's probably a lot harder, and I've already gained the ire of those I once tried to impress. But I'm happy, and that's honestly the most I could ask for. Audrey is not able to change, and in the end, is able to kill all the overseers and end the world. Quest successfully completed. But the bard, Miriam, and all those you've built connections with refuse to let the world end and come together to change fate. Ultimately, the world is restored. I hope the takeaway from this is to not be afraid of being yourself. You've probably heard that sentiment a million times by now, but it's also something that a lot of us struggle to actually follow through with. If that means you flamboyantly sing your heart out to everyone who would hear, or you find one person to dance a night away with and share feelings. Know that figuring yourself out can be scary and exhausting, but it's also incredibly liberating.
As we started working on this project, we quickly realized that empathy can be interpreted in many different ways. What most people think of when they hear the word is compassion. One, recognizing the suffering of others, and two, being emotionally motivated to help. But according to a book called Social Cognition and Metacognition in Schizophrenia, there's a third component to empathy called the theory of mind. This concept describes the cognitive skill to differentiate between our own mental states and those of others. It's the ability to comprehend that others have different beliefs and desires than we do, and that everyone feels different things based on their own views. While it sounds simple, this may be the most important element to empathy. Without being able to comprehend pluralism and the benefits of a diverse society, we would always act as independent authorities, potentially harming each other instead of cooperating. When we look at war-leading nations, we may notice that they work by the same rules. They act outside of their authority by ending lives for what they define as a greater good. Whether the head of state genuinely believes that, or just uses this mindset for war propaganda, they objectively ignore basic needs and rights of their enemies by engaging in war with them.
Hi there. My name is Colin Hill, and I run a video essay series dubbed Pondering Pixels. As an American in a post-9/11 world, there was always an intense feeling of patriotism that I felt at a young age. I was only 7 years old when I walked downstairs to see my mother crying while watching the news that tragic morning. That fear in her eyes as she lovingly tried to reassure me everything was fine is a memory I'll recall for the rest of my days. While I still hold the stance that America is a positive for the global stage, it can also be true that our young and powerful country is not without its flaws. Between Obama's drone strikes and Trump gassing his own citizens over a photo shoot with a Bible, we've had plenty of examples of those flaws in the last decade. Believe it or not, a video game is what initially showed me that Uncle Sam isn't always the purveyor of truth, justice, and the American way. This realization came to me while playing through a seemingly dead stealth action franchise. I enjoyed the Splinter Cell games for a variety of reasons, especially for the mechanics, level design, and the main character of the series. Sam Fisher always seemed like this badass mix between James Bond and Batman, a former Navy SEAL turned NSA covert operative that sticks to the shadows, utilizing his gadgets and his intellect to fight against terrorism and prevent World War III. Sam Fisher is a man who doesn't do what he does in the name of his country, but fights for his country in the name of individual freedom. He's a good man who cares enough to tell off his boss in the midst of a mission to honor someone who has made the ultimate sacrifice.
Fisher, I said leave the body. We don't have the means to extract him.
Just because he's dead doesn't mean I need to leave him here hanging like a piece of meat.
Don't get too connected, Fisher. I need you to stay rational.
You you can spare 30 seconds for some simple dignity.
In Splinter Cell Chaos Theory, our protagonist is sent on a mission to prevent the release of an algorithmic superweapon known as the Mass Kernels. This superweapon is capable of actions such as causing blackouts to entire regions of the globe and hacking into international supercomputers. Fisher eventually connects an old military friend named Douglas Shetland to what might be going on. Shetland is a former Marine who Fisher was quite close to in his time as a SEAL, as they often found themselves working alongside each other for various operations. As it turns out, Fisher discovers that Shetland is the CEO of a private military corporation named Displace International, and confirms it was this corporation using the mass kernels. This ultimately leads to a conflict between North and South Korea, and frames North Korea for launching a missile at the US Navy. Shetland was attempting to coordinate a war. Fisher tracks down Shetland, and this eventually leads to a standoff between the two.
It doesn't have to end like this, Sam.
No, but it does have to end.
On that, we agree. We've been fighting their dirty little wars our entire lives, and where do we end up? Staring at each other down the barrels of our guns. Nothing has changed, Fisher. And it won't change by degrees. We have to tear it down and start over. It's the only way.
Your own little chaos theory, throw the world into war and hope that what comes out the other side is better.
It will be better. Because this war will change things, Sam. Every other war has been about keeping things the same, but the status quo doesn't work anymore. America's sick, Sam. She's dying. The politicians, the bureaucrats, the whispered backroom deals, it's all life support for a sick old lady who was dead a long time ago.
The only backroom deals that I've seen lately were made by you. You're a murderer and a war criminal.
Those are the only names the state has for the revolutionary, Sam. You've only become a hero after the war is over. You know the truth. The world is built from the bottom up, not the other way around. Honor, courage, fidelity. We don't inherit these things from the world, Sam. We build the world from them. I know you. You believe in these things more than any government. And I know that because of it, you wouldn't shoot an old friend.
Right, Doug. I wouldn't shoot an old friend.
This scene opened my eyes to the idea that America isn't always the good guys. To be clear, I do not agree with the anarchist views of Shetland, but he did make some valid points. War is not black and white, and the country he once served is far from perfect. On the subject of conflict, perspective matters. Both of these men fought alongside each other for their country in the name of freedom. Both of these men had alternate perspectives as to what is the right thing to do, as Shetland found the mess too corrupt to fix. Fisher could still acknowledge those imperfections, as he's quite clear on not being a fan of bureaucrats. Yet he still chose to fight for the freedom of the American people. He refused to succumb to the idea that willfully allowing millions to die in the name of anarchy was the correct action to take. Fisher felt this so strongly, he was willing to kill a man he once would have fought alongside to the bitter end. As I write this out, I'm reminded of the incredible line from V for Vendetta. People should not be afraid of their governments. Governments should be afraid of their people. My country is far from perfect, but we must remember that the United States is not its government. America is an idea, and a nation of hundreds of millions of good-natured people. People that, regardless of how much they fight amongst themselves, genuinely want what is best for the world. For the individual to be empowered, to have the freedom to speak their mind, and to hold the right to protect that freedom. The right to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness.
In philosophy, the term othering is used for the phenomenon when we create a socially inferior group of the others by excluding and distancing ourselves from people we can't identify with. In 1807, German philosopher Hegel, one of the greatest influences on Karl Marx, introduced this concept as a protective response to conflicting values of the self and the other. However, in his book Phenomenology of Spirit, he says that we need to overcome this kind of relationships, which he further describes in the master-slave dialect. His main argument is that two conflicting consciousnesses always see each other as a threat, and will try to destroy each other in order to dominate. But since these consciousnesses are codependent, like a master and their slave, there is no outcome of the situation where only one of them is going down. Hegel's proposition to this issue is to overcome our self-consciousness to be able to reconcile with the otherness. And that is not only an overcomplicated way to describe empathy, but also what many games encourage us to do. Video games like Undertale, Gone Home, What Remains of Edith Finch, Wonder Song, and Chaos Theory. Each one of them shows us an insight into either our own consciousness or those of others. They are all tools that help us zoom out and view things from different perspectives so that we can let loose of our own. In one word, they are...
So there's this documentary show on the History Channel called Ancient Aliens. They kind of explore all these kind of things around the world, but they tie it together with the most stupid proposition that there are ancient aliens that have come throughout history to provide technology to mankind. And it is ridiculous. But the thing that they do really well is kind of like show you parts of the world that are not in general consciousness, if you know what I mean. That's quite interesting. So, and I like that when it comes in video games. So like when you're playing Civilization, you get to like pick a, you know, a world leader from history to kind of control. And when you kind of like, who is this person? Who is, you know, Bismarck? I don't know who Bismarck was. You know, you kind of go down Wikipedia and then go down that rabbit hole. It's the stepping off point of learning more. Telling a story that of parts of the world that we kind of ignore is important. Like, we have so many games that are based in feudal Japan and Europe and America and like medieval Europe, right? Yet there is so much more in this world. Like, just 1979 Iran, or even any point in history and any other place in the world, have stories to tell, and I believe it is important for those stories to be told. I'm not entirely sure about the history of how paintings and, you know, film and photography have gotten. Like, obviously, like when people started with those, they kind of used it as documentarian kind of standards, right? Like capture the painting of the king of this region and so on. Games never really had that, right? That kind of experimentation phase early on. They had that kind of like, oh shit, we can make money out of this. Let's get people to pay to play the game. And I mean, obviously, over the last three decades, they've been trying to implement more and more kind of empathetic and story-driven elements in games as we've had increases in, you know, technology. But I don't think we're completely there yet, one that kind of fully kind of connects me. Like, Hellblade objectively has something very important to say, right? I don't particularly enjoy the game. It's an important game. It does an excellent job in representing schizophrenia and psychosis. But the reason I don't particularly like it is because the entire focus is on what essentially is this video game character who is entirely kind of like bound by it. Obviously, like, the character is going through a very stressful period in their existence. However, like, for me, it's their life is kind of defined by it, if you will. That's a thing in games, I guess. They have a trait or two, which is what defines the character, right? And there is nothing more to them.
Games aren't anywhere near perfect. They aren't even good, for the most part. What we are trying to convey is that they could be better, because we have seen many examples that prove that. These were some of many aspects of interactive and immersive media that are frequently overlooked in the public discourse, and that should be focused on more, in my opinion. Games will certainly not make you a better person, but they do have the ability to teach what is considered good, bad, and important in our society. Video games play a major role in many people's lives, including mine. They are easily the type of media I put the most time into, and I dare say the same is true for most of the other collaborators. We all love playing them, but that doesn't allow us to look the other way when we notice issues with games that should be addressed. One-dimensional characters, inaccurate and false representation of minorities, Gamergate, and the general unwillingness to make games accessible to a wider range of consumers all work against what we would like to witness one day. Opinion havers who consider each other's perceptions, players who are treated right by a public piece of media, more games that tell an important story, and last but not least, companies that care. So that's it. That's the end of the video. It feels really weird to end this video in any way because it's become like part of my life now to edit this like almost every single day. And it's hard to say goodbye, I just realized. But that's it. I hope you enjoyed it. And if so, make sure to subscribe and rate the video, and maybe if you wanna, you could support me on Patreon with $1 per video. But I really just wanna take this moment and thank my collaborators who really cared about this project and put out something really substantial, and I really appreciate that, so thank you. And yeah, I think that's it. This is the end. I wish you a Merry Christmas, of course, and a Happy New Year, and I hope to see you in the next year. More videos will be coming soon enough. I don't know when, but they are on the way. Bye-bye.